What did you do in response to those who were in need? Those who were hungry, those who were thirsty. And I would tell you that that's not just talking about making sure they have physical food and physical drink, but are we sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ, the living waters of the gospel, to bring about hope and transformation in people's lives? Are we sharing the love of Jesus with people? What are we doing in response to strangers? The Bible tells us to make sure we show hospitality to strangers. Be intent and attentive to showing hospitality to strangers, because in some who have done so have even entertained angels without even realizing. One night, I was sitting there studying Hebrews chapter 13, and I was preparing for a sermon for Sunday, and it was on a Thursday night. And this Thursday night, as I was preparing for this sermon on this scripture, and the scripture was saying to me, I just had read the scripture, says, be attentive to show hospitality to strangers. Less than a couple of minutes later, Christy comes into my office there at the parsonage at the last church I pastored, and she said, there's a guy out here that's a black fellow. He's deaf and he's mute. And he says someone is just, now, you think I'm making this up, right? I mean, it sounds pretty weird already. When you start walking with the Lord, some strange stuff may happen. This fella, deaf and mute, someone has stolen his blanket or his sleeping bag and his food, and he's hitchhiking, and he needs some help. He just wants some blankets, and he wants some food if we can share some. Well, I'm a little dense sometimes, and I need some help. And you'll learn that. You're already seeing some of that already, okay? I need all the help I can get. So obviously God was preparing me to receive this fellow. Okay? I invited him in, and he looked at me like I was just slapped him upside the head. He's like, come in. People usually didn't treat him that way. He didn't expect to be invited into my house. I mean, he smelled pretty bad too, y'all. I mean, that has nothing to do with it, but it was a rough-looking character. And I invited him into the house and set him down at the table, the beautiful dining room table that we had there in the parsonage. And we got him some food. Christy had made him some food, and we set him, you know, a bowl of soup and crackers in front of him and something to drink. And then we began to pack some food, and some other ladies from the church who were at this Bible study that Christy was doing, you know, at the church that night that first met this fella, they brought some blankets over. And then I took him to pick up his stuff. He was hitchhiking all the way to Maine, he said. And there was a time in this whole scenario where I was wondering whether this guy was really human or not. I think he really was, but I was wondering. Is this for real? Is this a real human being, or is this an angel? But anyway, I took him and got his stuff, and I dropped him off about 2 or 3 miles down the road, and that's all he wanted. He didn't want any money, never asked for any money. He just needed a little bit of help to get him on his way a little bit further. Well, Friday came and went, Saturday came, and Christy and I were invited to go to a North Carolina State football game with a guy in our church named Tom Huskett. Tom went to every home football game, but he needed someone to take him to each game, so he would invite someone different to take him to each game. He was born blind. He went to every single home game, though. Loved North Carolina State. Had a very close relationship with a guy named Lou Holtz. And Lou Holtz, apparently, I didn't even realize was a coach there at one time, years and years ago. Just a very wonderful character. So we went to this football game and came back, and it was kind of late. Mama was at home with the kids, and Christy and I got back and just went to bed. And next morning, Grace came in and woke me up. And she said, Dad, Patrick came back. And I kind of woke myself up and said, what? And she said, Patrick came back last night while y'all were gone. I said, oh, okay. I said, well, what did you do? She goes, well, I let him in. And I jumped up and said, what? Now, Mama was at home with the kids, but what's Mama going to do? She's going to beat him with her oxygen tank or something? I mean, if something bad were to happen. So we had a talk. You know, we had to talk about strangers and not, you know, being careful. You do need to be careful, right? Okay. So anyway, after I kind of gathered myself and got over that a little bit. I went on over to the church, and I went into the church that morning to kind of get some things ready, and I noticed that one of my Bibles was laying on the altar at my church. And it was opened to Revelation 16 and 17. And I remembered that distinctly. And I looked at it, and I was like, And I had a lay leader I was pretty close with there, and I thought, well, Dennis might be kind of up to something. I didn't know what it was there for. And I was also wondering, why is my Bible there? How did it get over here? Anyway, I was like, did I do that? You know, I'm forgetful, so I didn't know. It was weird. And then Dennis, my lay leader, came in, and he saw it, opened up to Revelation 16 and 17. Couldn't figure that out. I remembered that chapter, though, those chapters distinctly. Well, a little bit later that day, that morning, I went back to the house before church, and this guy came back again. His name was Patrick. And we were having a conversation by writing notes back and forth. And Patrick said, I can't get a ride. You know, I'm trying to get a ride a little bit further down the road. Can you take me? I said, well, I can at about 1 o'clock today. And he got a little agitated with me. And I said, well, I'm a preacher. I'm a little busy this morning. Now, you know, I can help you this afternoon. And he said, okay. He said, well, I'm going to go try to get a ride. But this is a long story. There's a lot of things about it. He was asking some strange questions about cremation and different things, too, while we were there. But he said, I'm going to try to get a ride, and if I can, I'll come back. Well, at the middle of our worship service, which I invited him to, he actually ended up coming back. And he sat down in the middle of the church in the back pews, and you know, people welcomed him. They were a little bit alarmed to see this fellow coming in. He was dressed sort of weird and smelled pretty bad, and it was a little bit awkward situation, but they welcomed him. And I began to share with him who he was and why he was there. He couldn't hear a word I was saying. Couldn't hear one thing. And I never told people to do anything. I told him I was just going to give him a ride later that day, and I didn't tell him to do anything. But at the end of the service, people just, out of the goodness of their hearts, the Lord led them to just start handing him money. They started handing him 20s and 50s and 100s. He ended up with $200 or $300. And he was sitting there like, what's going on? You know, and he was wondering, and there's a little young lady in the church who spoke sign language, and she began to sign, just saying, people just want to help. They just want to help. And he accepted, and somebody else on the way out said, let's get the guy a bus ticket. He's trying to hitchhike to Maine. Let's get him a bus ticket. So we finally talked him into accepting a bus ticket. And later that day, we were on our way back down to Durham to drop him off at the bus station. My lay leader was with me, and I said, Dennis, just write him a note and ask him if he's been in contact with Jehovah's Witnesses. It just came to me, and he did, and the guy, he saw the note, and he went, how did you know? He wrote back, how did you know? And then he pulled out this little yellow book that he had apparently memorized from cover to cover, and he had a lot of questions because of this little yellow book that he had read. And then later that day at Arby's there in Durham, we were able to share with him some things that were different about our church and why our church was a little bit different. He had actually taken a Bible from my house that Friday night, and he took it over to our church, and he laid it on our altar and opened up to Revelation 16 and 17, because chapter 17 talks about the great mystery or the great whore of Babylon. And many people interpret that to be talking about false religion. And his statement to me and to my church was, you guys are a whore church, a false church, governed by Satan. Because that's what he had read in that little yellow book. All other churches are run by Satan. And we were able to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. And he saw that this little whorehouse church that he had in his mind, I mean, forgive the language, but that's the language. Scripture is pretty graphic sometimes. Idolatry is referred to as a spiritual adultery. So I apologize for the language, but that's the language of the Bible. This church that he deemed to be a whorehouse church was a church that reached out to him in love. And I want to say, touched him and changed his life, possibly that day. Well, I was sharing this story the other night, and I know this is long, but this is interesting, I hope. I was sharing this story a couple of Wednesdays ago. with our middle school youth group at the Wonderful Wednesdays program, because Grace brought it up in the Wonderful Wednesdays program. She brought this story up, and I started telling them about it, and I started telling them about this passage of Scripture, and we read it. And then after that, I came over here to choir practice. I came over here, and we were at choir practice, and Terry, at the end of choir practice, always leads the choir in a prayer, praying for specific requests. And as Terry began to get requests, we heard a voice call out from the back of the church in the darkness. And he said, could y'all pray for me? And we couldn't really see who it was because the light was out back here. Now, I know the folks in the choir were a little bit alarmed. Were you not, Paula? It's a little alarming, right? But something was telling me, because I'm a little dense, I just shared this story in this scripture about Patrick with this group, and then all of a sudden, here's this guy who shows up, and he wants prayer. He was reluctant to come forward, but I invited him to come forward, and he did. And he shared some of his struggles, and I guessed how we could help him the best we could, and I prayed for him. And then since then, I've been in contact with him, you know, on a regular basis. His name's Marlon. Marlon White. It was a black fellow with a hoodie on back there. A little bit scary, right? But the Lord sent him here, and it was no accident. I just talked with him the other day. Again. And then, Benny and I were talking after Alpha the other night. Benny's just finished our Alpha course, and we were talking about a friend of his. And Benny said, I understand that you've met my friend's mother. We've helped his mother with some food and stuff here at the church before. And I said, yeah, I remember Mickey Moore. And he said, yeah. He said, my friend's Justin. I said, well, I've never really met Justin. Well, I was taking my mother home that afternoon after Alpha. She lives in Cherrible, right? So I was going to Cherrible, and on the way back, I see this guy walking down the road. Long-haired guy. And as I passed by, I just knew I needed to go back and ask him if he wanted a ride. And as I pulled up and rolled down the window to pick him up, I said, is your last name, I don't even know where this came from, is your last name Moore? And he looked at me like I was nuts and said, yeah. I said, well, I know this is going to sound crazy, but I was just talking about you with your friend Benny. And he was telling me about some of the troubles that you're having. And what are you up to? I want to give you a ride if you need a ride. You need a ride? He said, yeah, I'm going to Gastonia. He went all the way to the other side of Gastonia. So I took him, and as we were going, I was sharing the gospel with this young man. A young man like all of us who, and anybody that in life who longs and hungers and thirsts after righteousness, I was sharing the good news of Jesus Christ with him, and found out some other things. And he was having a bad day, a real bad day, that day. Showing hospitality to strangers. I need a little extra help, and all of us, I think, probably could be in that same category. We need a little extra help. God's willing to help us. God's willing to guide us if we will listen and pay attention. When we really start living this gospel, some weird things might start happening, but they're beautiful and awesome things. And I've learned since I met this fellow named Justin that there's another way that I can help him, and I'm going to. And Steve White just happened to come over yesterday and was trying to figure out what he and the United Methodist men might be able to do to help somebody. I know I didn't meet that fellow by accident. You think I met that fellow by accident? Pat, you think I met that fellow by accident? Laura, how about you? You think I met that fellow by accident? Peggy? Two Peggies? Lynn?
So this happened to me,
too. Amen. God's at work. Jesus is coming back. And one of the criteria by which we will be judged is how we have reached out to those in need and how we have treated strangers. Amen.